Well, at 20 minutes to five, we can now say the decision taken in 1975 by this country to join the common market has been reversed by this referendum to leave the EU.
So let me say, it is my high honor and distinct privilege to introduce to you the President-elect of the United States of America, Donald Trump.
This strategy recognizes that whether we like it or not, we are engaged in a new era of competition. We accept that vigorous military, economic, and political contests are now playing out all around the world.
The world is changing. Since Britain's vote to leave the European Union and the election of Donald Trump as President of the United States, in 2016, all that was certain in world politics has evaporated into air. The political relationships between major Western nations are becoming antagonistic, with disagreements over trade between the US, Canada, and the European Union resulting in increasingly aggressive political confrontations. The belligerence of US foreign policy under Trump threatens to shatter the long-standing alliance between these nations. Even as these tensions play out, the West is openly preparing itself for confrontation with Russia and China. Along Russia's western border, the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, or NATO, has a military line running from Estonia to Poland under the name Enhanced Forward Presence. Described as a deterrent, this line is the largest force stationed in Europe since the end of the so-called Cold War, armed to the teeth with the latest military equipment and primed for a rapid attack. China is similarly encircled, with over 400 US military bases surrounding its borders. These military nooses are complemented by an ongoing campaign of diplomatic and economic aggression, with Russia and China the target of sanctions and diplomatic expulsions. To put things bluntly, we stand upon the precipice of a global confrontation. In economic and in political terms, the world cannot be maintained in the way that it has been. In this film, we will look at the causes of this confrontation and the political strategies of those Western powers that stand at its heart. This is not an idle task. Rather, it is intended to pose a question. As the world heads closer and closer toward the kind of inordinate bloodletting that characterized the First and Second World War, we must ask how it may be prevented. In order to make sense of the events shaking world politics, we first need to understand something fundamental about our society. Our world is dominated by the social system of capitalist imperialism. What is imperialism? Many of us would recognize its more visible symptoms as naked attempts to secure power or resources for wealthy nations. For example, the 2003 Iraq War. Observing this power grab is not enough to get to the heart of the matter. No society can be understood simply in terms of the blood it has spilt, no matter how deep those rivers may run. If we wish to understand the essential and defining characteristics of a social system, we must look beyond its appearance and attempt to understand the basis of how it functions. Imperialism is a form of capitalism. Thus, we must begin by approaching how capitalism functions in general. This is precisely the task undertaken by the revolutionary philosopher Karl Marx, most clearly in his famous Das Kapital. Whilst capitalism is often described as the existence of a free market, this definition tells us nothing about how it functions. The scientific and historical approach offered in Capital provides a far more complete picture than this. In Marx's analysis, capitalism is commodity production at its highest stage of development, where even human labour power itself becomes a commodity. Crucially, this production is organised through the relations of private property. The bourgeoisie, or capitalist class, who own machines, factories, land, and wealth, invest in production to gather commodities they may sell at a profit. In contrast, the proletariat, or working class, have nothing to sell save for their own ability to work, known as labour power. As such, the working class sell their labour power to the capitalist class in the form of wage labour. This relationship is one of exploitation. In examining the commodity, Marx asks a very simple question which reveals this. To paraphrase, why is it that a certain number of candles are worth the same amount as a coat, or several pairs of socks the same amount as a chicken? What do any commodities hold in common? The answer cannot be found in the properties of the commodity itself. Candles are not comparable to coats in how they are used, nor can one of these uses be said to be more valuable than the other. In fact, the only thing that these commodities hold in common is that they are all products of human labour. As such, the value of a commodity is determined by the quantity of socially averaged labour it takes to produce. For profit to be derived from commodity production, the capitalist class must pay the working class less in wages than their labour produces. This exploitation is not necessarily achieved by a sleight of hand or by underpaying the workers, but rather by the logic of commodity exchange itself. As the working class sell their labour power as a commodity, its value is determined by what it takes to reproduce. In other words, the value of a worker's ability to work is determined by the food, shelter, transport, etc. required to get them back to work the next day. What is unique to labour power as a commodity is that it produces more value than it costs to reproduce. This is the source of profit. The relationship of exploitation between proletariat and bourgeoisie is what Marx terms productive or industrial capital. It is the only form of capital which produces new value. As capitalism develops, it tends towards periodic crises in industry and in politics. This is a result of what Marx terms the historical tendency of the rate of profit to fall. To expand production and remain competitive on the free market, the capitalist class are forced to attempt to increase the productivity of the workers they employ. This is achieved by investing in more and more productive machinery. However, these increases only provide temporary competitive benefits to individual capitalists or firms. As productivity averages across an industry, the value of the commodities being sold declines as they require less socially averaged labour power to produce. As such, an ever greater proportion of the capitalist's investment is taken up by investment in machinery and its maintenance, and an ever smaller proportion rendered as profit. As the amount of profit relative to capital invested declines, investments no longer appear profitable. This leads to the hoarding of money, known to Marx as overaccumulation, and a breakdown in production as no profitable investments can be found. Crises follow. This is an absolute process. The rate of profit has an historical tendency to fall towards zero. To Marx, therefore, capitalism is a class society organized to meet the needs of profit accumulation. The stratification of society into the extortionately wealthy and the dispossessed is not an accident or a mistake of policy, but a fundamental need of capitalism. Whilst competition between capitalists leads to advances in technology, these same technological advances cause it to break down, leading to economic deprivation, gross inequality, and enormous violence. This cannot be controlled or fixed whilst capitalism continues to exist. By the beginning of the 20th century, capitalism had clearly developed beyond the parameters of the free market. Rather than the competition between individual capitalist enterprises, which had in general characterized capitalism's development previously, the major capitalist nations tended toward economies dominated by monopoly. Many authors and theorists began to discuss this development under the term imperialism, notably the English economist J.A. Hobson in 1902 and the Austrian Marxist Rudolf Hilferding in 1910. However, these explanations failed to grasp the full significance of imperialism's development. It fell to the Russian Marxist and revolutionary Vladimir Lenin to provide a clear and concrete definition of the phenomenon in his 1916 pamphlet, Imperialism, the Highest Stage of Capitalism. Lenin begins his definition of imperialism by an analysis of the formation of monopolies. After describing the emergence of monopolies in the US, Germany, and Britain, Lenin develops Marx's understanding that the free market leads towards an ever-increasing concentration of production. As capitalism develops, production concentrates in the hands of those capitalist enterprises which have managed to compete successfully. Over time, they become larger and their influence greater. Due to the enormous amount of capital employed by these industries, it becomes ever more difficult to gather the resources necessary to launch new enterprises capable of competing with them. This scale also allows for the combination of different industries, so one capitalist enterprise may deal in both the processing of raw materials and the production of manufactured goods. Cartels form between the largest enterprises, enabling them to fix prices and the quantity of goods to be produced, or to divide markets and profits between themselves. Competition between small and large industries vanishes. Instead, the monopolists asphyxiate those that do not submit to their will. Competition thus grows into monopoly. The emergence of monopoly has a specific relevance to the role of the banks in capitalist society. In the earlier stages of capitalist development, the banks were but humble middlemen for the making of payments. However, just as competition leads to a concentration of production in the hands of individual capitalist enterprises, so too does competition produce a concentration of capital in the hands of the banks. As more and more capital is deposited in the banks, their power increases. The industrial capitalists are made reliant upon the banks in order to gain access to capital. In turn, the banks can ascertain exactly the financial position of various capitalists, control them, and ultimately entirely determine their fate. Lenin describes this as the coalescence or merging of banking and industrial capital, transforming them into finance capital. As such, the epoch of imperialism is one in which the domination of society by capital in general is replaced by the domination of finance capital. In class terms, this means that the dominant class of imperialist society is no longer the bourgeoisie in general, but specifically those who own the banks. A financial oligarchy. The development of monopoly in industry and monopoly associations in the banks leads to a change in the form of exports produced by a nation. Whereas the earlier stages of capitalist development typically relied upon the export of goods in international trade, imperialist nations typically export capital, that is, investment. This is a consequence of overaccumulation in the imperialist nations. Put simply, the development of enormous industries in the imperialist nations leads towards a falling rate of profit and consequently a lack of profitable investments within these nations. The resulting surplus of capital is then exported and invested in less developed nations where wages and land prices are lower. As the owners of this investment, the imperialists are generally able to agree loan terms that favour the investors. As such, the relationship between oppressed and oppressor nations under colonialism is transformed only superficially. Instead of the old form of exploitation, under which the capitalists used their empires to secure raw materials for production at home, imperialism favours a form of exploitation based upon usury capital. This is known as super-exploitation. The consequence of this export of capital is simple. Over time, the world is entirely divided between capitalist associations. International cartels form and negotiate the division of territories and profits between themselves. Once enough capital has been exported, this results in the complete division of the world between great powers, that is, those imperialists dominant in the world economy. Once such a division of the world has been achieved, capital stagnates, unable to find profitable investments across the sphere of the globe. Now, only a redivision of the world between competing imperialist powers is possible. The consequences of such a redivision were revealed to the world in a torrent of blood during the First and Second World Wars. Times Square, New York. A labyrinth of glittering billboards rises into Manhattan night, forming a delirious canopy. Here, the domination of monopolies is not only evident, it is exalted in a never-ceasing dance of light and image. The gaudy cathedrals of US imperialism hold this space in thrall. At their feet, a river of humanity is cast in shadow. Though many claim that the analysis of capitalism offered by Marx and Lenin is outmoded or incorrect, it is increasingly relevant. Today, the system of capitalist imperialism is much the same as it was in Lenin's time. The world wars did not secure lasting peace between the world's great imperialist powers, but merely a temporary reprieve.